Aloha, everybody. Jeremy Vaeni here. I am your host on this week's show. Actually, pretty much every week's show, except for that one time Whitley had to fill in for me. Lucky all of us that I'm back. On last week's show, in the comments section, Andy111 wrote something that I tried to respond to and couldn't because for some reason the comments wouldn't take. And it's funny because I saw there were three commenters thus far on that thread, and one of them was wondering where is everybody, essentially, was trying to start conversation. And I think the problem is that Whitley's having a problem with the comment section, but not for long, for he has actually shown me the new website, which he may launch by the time you hear this. I don't know. It's coming very, very soon. It looks very nice, very cool. And all of these issues should be going away. And Whitley kindly offered to post whatever comment I wanted to make, but of course I opened that on my mobile phone and then said, oh, well, I'll do that later when I'm on a computer and my chubby fingers aren't hitting small keys, but are hitting computer keys. And then I forgot. So Whitley, I apologize. I never even got back to you. And the comment I wanted to make was actually a question for Andy111, who was talking about having out-of-body experiences and feeling a vibratory, tingly sensation. And I was wondering, is that as an entity out of the body, or is it a physiological thing that you're feeling in the body? In other words, is there a tether between the out-of-body entity and the body? Can you feel what's going on in the body at all? Or is that sensation, for which you have no senses to pick up a such a sensation, you don't have touch as an outside entity, you don't have a nervous system, right? So I'm wondering, how are you feeling vibration? Is your sense of it that even though you don't have a nervous system or any of that, that this entity, this formless awareness, is picking up physical sensation? Or is it that you can still feel the body? Of course, I would have made that less convoluted if I'd actually left a comment. So my apologies. This week's show features my friend Regan Lee, who is here from the blogosphere, another formless entity out there in the world, the blogosphere. We used to both write for UFO Magazine. And then magazines died a horrible, horrible death. And now we don't write for that anymore. So, but you can find her writings, well, a bunch of places. But her primary source is orangeorb.blogspot.com. And from there, you can gain access to all of her websites. So check her stuff out. What is an orange orb? What was her orange orb experience? Well, we're going to talk about that. We're going to talk about a lot of things. So get ready. Here comes mystery wrapped in a riddle, wrapped in an enigma that is a human life. Right after these messages for non-subscribers. For subscribers, it's alive, alive right now. Aloha, Jeremy Vaeni here, and I want to tell you about my latest undertaking, OurUndoing.com. OurUndoing.com is a multimedia website where if you watch, if you read, if you listen, without trying to absorb knowledge like we do with normal learning, and without the normal judgmental filters that we use to compare and contrast so-called spiritual knowledge, if we watch, if we read, if we listen, without all of that, we may just wake up to our full human nature. That is what this website is for. It's not about what we're doing, it's about who we are, truly are, when we're off the pendulum of duality. If your life is about seeking truth above all else, look no further. Join me at OurUndoing.com.
They are found deep in a dying jungle, 6 infants. They aren't apes. They aren't human either, not quite. So, what are they? When they are spirited off to the United States, an incredible discovery is made. They are as smart as us, but not us, not human. The company that found them wants to buy and sell them as the most valuable animals on Earth, brilliant workers who need not be paid. Somebody has to stop this travesty, and that's where primatologist Beth Cook comes in. But can she stand up to the power and wealth that seeks to exploit them? Find out in Whitley Strieber's first standalone science fiction novel in 7 years. New. Get it on Amazon as an ebook or paperback.
Ladies and gentlemen, without further ado, please welcome to the program my old pal, Regan Lee. Regan, thank you for coming on the show.
You're welcome. Thank you for having me.
You haven't been on this show, have you?
No, I have not.
I wonder why that is.
I don't know.
I don't know that it's a real mystery, but I just like to make it awkward. But thankfully, I put out the call, and here you are. And if anyone else would like to come on the show, please, jeremy@unknowncountry.com, write me and come on the show. Hopefully, it will be as fabulous as the episode we're about to have. So I know some of your background, but I don't know if this audience will. You have been heavily involved in the blog scene of ufology and paranormal shenanigans. You are also a writer for UFO Magazine. Tell me if I'm missing anything. What is it that draws you to this and makes you want to write about this on, you know, multiple formats and even multiple blogs? What so draws you to do that?
I wish I knew. Truly, I just kind of have to. Although lately I've been not as prolific or active as I have been. I have been internally, like in my head every day, I'm always going, you know, what was that about? But as far as a presence online, I've been a little quieter than usual. Maybe because there's so much to talk about. Sometimes I find myself sort of spinning around, like, he did what? They said what about this? This is happening? Are you kidding? You know, so I just sort of...
Well, do you feel as so many people do who have experiences that they must talk about this at all costs? It's the most important thing ever. We got to convince the world fill in the blank is real. Do you feel that way?
No.
Did you ever feel that way?
No. I felt like I needed to share my experiences, partly to help me figure it out. You know, it was a process that worked for me, and partly to communicate with others and connect with others who have also had these experiences. And along the way, of course, I've always had people just come out and attack me, sometimes in very ugly ways. That also, fortunately, has seemed to quiet it down somewhat. But so I'm not out there to convince anyone of anything. Weird things have happened to me. They continue to happen. Sometimes I find them really interesting and exciting or a little unnerving. And it's sharing for communication and also the process of trying to figure it out for myself. But if someone chooses not to believe me, fine. I don't know what the answers are. I don't know what it means. So I'm not going to tell anybody else. You know, I'll share with what I think might be going on. And I often change my views or theories or, you know. But I'm not out there to convince people and tell them. In fact, I'm very much believe in beware the messenger. You know, just because the messenger says this is so, that doesn't mean it is so. It just means that's what they're telling you.
Right. And are you talking here about the paranormal messenger?
Yes. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, see, now that's a very intelligent, sort of interesting take, because the surface level thing, which is the thing that we initially deal with, you know, you would think that for most people would take precedence and would become the nature of the reality for them. That I think most people probably don't ponder beyond that. They ponder that and think that's the depth of the subject, but then not an even greater depth, which is to step out and go, wait a minute, is that true? Like, I know that happened, but what was real about it and
right.
What was metaphor
exactly.
And so on. So give us some examples from your life of things that maybe you looks completely literally like, okay, I see examples of that in the books I've read, in the testimonies I've seen in documentaries. But then there comes a turning point where you start to think, maybe not. Maybe I shouldn't trust this. What would be an example of that from your life?
Well, oh boy. I think the whole, I'll say alien entity or non-human thing that has come to me in various forms since childhood. And I don't know, and they're often associated with UFOs, UFO sightings, seeing craft. And along the way, my husband has had his own experiences, and sometimes they are since his childhood. And some, and we have similar childhoods, in fact, just generally speaking. We even found out we lived not too far from each other when we were younger, before we met. You know, little things like that. So often people will suggest, you know, some kind of weird alien karmic thing going on. But I wonder, I don't know, because sometimes these things, they weren't really alien-like, like the grays, for example. But the most recent thing that I thought was really crazy cool, I work for a school district, and there's, oh boy, I don't even know how many elementary schools in our district. Okay, so I just, you know, came out at work quite some time ago about what I think and what I'm into, and if they want to think I'm nuts, fine, whatever. And some people do, and some people think it's really interesting, actually, and I've had some really interesting conversations about the paranormal and UFOs and Sasquatch and what have you. And, you know, some people just roll their eyes. I don't care. So I loaned Edges of Science by Tom Powell to a coworker. And then this coworker told me, oh, you should talk to so-and-so's father who volunteers here. He had an experience with Sasquatch, and he was with a researcher, a Bigfoot researcher. I said, oh, well, who was it? He said, I don't know. I don't know the name. I said, okay. So I talked to this person. The person tells me he was with Ron Moorhead. I said, really? That's exciting, you know. And then it turns out, so I was naming all these researchers. I said, oh, have you heard of so-and-so and so-and-so? And then I said, have you heard of Toby Johnson? He's another Bigfoot researcher here in Oregon. And the person said, that's my cousin. I said, get out! And it was like so exciting. It turns out this other person that I've worked side by side with for years is a total believer in Sasquatch, and including all the stranger aspects of Sasquatch encounters, you know, the more kind of paranormal things that go on.
Yeah, because that's not even a really popular thing to believe, right, still?
No, no. I think, though, it's maybe becoming a little more accepted. At least I don't think people are so willing to beat each other up at conferences over it, and, you know, anyway, so I just thought it's very interesting that this little synchronicity of these relationships, I mean, these people could have been in any school, they were in the school I work at, and we work very closely together physically in the building, we're next to each other practically, so I just thought that was very interesting. I mean,
for sure.
Of all the elementary schools and of all the,
yeah.
You know, so that's pretty cool. So I'm going to be attending some of their meetings and, you know, just find out what I can find out about things, because there is a lot of Sasquatch activity here in the Pacific Northwest.
And you've seen Sasquatch?
No, I have not.
You dated a Sasquatch?
Yeah, well, we won't go there, but yeah, no. I did have one weird experience, and I don't know why. There's no reason at all why in my head, in the back of my mind, I think maybe it has to do with Bigfoot. Because I didn't see a Bigfoot. I wasn't, you know, I had nothing to do with that. But I was taking a drive in the country, just, you know, nice drive, beautiful day, beautiful everything. I go up the top of a hill. To my right is the valley, beautiful view. And behind me across the narrow road is just steep hillside, heavily forested. And I'm standing there looking at the view. Everything is great, gorgeous. I'm feeling really good. All of a sudden, I could feel it physically behind, coming from the hills behind me, this horrible negative, and it was like rolling towards me like a wave of negative energy. And I heard, get out, like get out. And it just, at first I thought, what is, you know, what? And then I said, I better listen to this. I'm leaving. Fine.
Was it an external voice?
Yes.
We'll be back after this.
You know, The Afterlife Revolution is a funny book. It makes people happy, even though it's about the afterlife and thinking about crossing over. It made me happy to write it. And the reason it did was that I was actually in touch with Anne while I was writing it. And not only that, she proved it. She proved it clearly and completely. When you read the book, you'll see what I mean. You'll see why Dr. Gary Schwartz, who is one of the leading experts on the afterlife, considers it such an important book, why he wrote a foreword for it. Because this is about something real and incredible that we are told every day not to believe that we have souls and that we have an afterlife. Well, we do. We do. And The Afterlife Revolution is going to open the door for you so you're not going to be thinking to yourself, maybe I don't, when you do. And that's why it's a book of joy. Go on Amazon, take a look at the great reviews, and get yourself a copy. It's available for your Kindle. It's available in paperback. And there's an audiobook read by me. And let me tell you something. You can hear something in my voice. People tell me that, and I think it's true. You know what it is? It's the inner joy that is part of me and has become part of me since this extraordinary thing happened. I have to say, Anne Strieber was a remarkable person in this life, and she still is. Get it today.
Whitley Strieber's nonfiction is magical, powerful, and thought-provoking. From Communion to The Afterlife Revolution, there is no body of work like it in the world. Nothing even approaches it. And not only that, his wonderful fiction, from The Wolfen to his latest novel, New, offers reading and listening entertainment that you will never forget. And where do you find all this in one place? At Strieber.com. That's where. Every Whitley Strieber book available for sale is there, as well as a pre-order link for New. So don't wait. Go to Strieber.com and start exploring. There's only one Whitley and only one place to find all his work. Strieber.com.
Welcome back.
So in the air, you heard get out. Was it a male voice or female?
It was. I would say it had a male energy or feel to it, if anything, you know. And who knows what that was? It could have been anything. Anything at all. Who knows? So I left. You know,
well, what was your feeling about what it was? Do you feel that it was an entity of some sort, or do you feel the place itself didn't want you around, or people? Or
good
something
question.
Else?
I think it was something, spirit, energy, you know, that had to do with the place. I don't think it was the place itself, but I think it was something that lived in that place that for some reason we crossed paths.
Right. But do you think there are some places that maybe, you know, this, what we think of as spirits and what we think of as the spirit of the land are, mm-hmm. are enmeshed in such a way that, there's only a difference mm-hmm. if we see one, but there really isn't a difference. Like, you know, when we, Carol and I first moved here, when we were looking at places, there was a place up the mountain that was absolutely gorgeous in the middle of this Ohia forest that was completely off the grid and it was idyllic. But we both got the feeling of we shouldn't be here for some reason.
Mm-hmm.
Get out. Mm-hmm. But it was a feeling. It wasn't a voice, yeah. but we both had it and it was clear.
Right.
And so we respected that and didn't buy the place.
Right.
But I wonder if, you know, if I were a psychic medium or something along those lines, if I had those abilities, would I see a spirit involved? Would I, you know what I mean? But does it matter if I do?
Right.
Because the place itself and this, whatever the thing that we consider to be a spirit might be one at some point, you know, just through the state of, you know, a spirit being sort of formless, timeless energy, one assumes.
Mm-hmm.
Do they become right. enmeshed in some way? And then just because we're dualistic creatures, do we create two things? I guess that's what I'm asking.
Oh, no doubt.
I'm like, perfect.
I'll go for that.
Excellent. Next question.
Definitely. No, there are definitely some places around here that years ago, Jim and I were looking at property and nice little, in fact, it's really cool. It was like these sort of dome-shaped buildings put together as a house. I mean, it's kind of weird, but cool. Out in the country, and, you know, but the place, oh, we just had such, we couldn't wait to get out of there. It was just a spooky, weird feeling, like, oh, we didn't even want to drive through. We couldn't wait to leave. And there are a few spots like that around here for sure. And in fact, this place we were looking at, I found out years later, another coworker had grown up in the area, and she said her house was haunted when she was growing up. So, you know, who knows? I mean.
Hmm. Now, you mentioned that you've had alien-ish type phenomena. Mm-hmm. What would those be?
Oh, you know. No, I really don't mean to be flip. It's just my nature. I'm just sort of a smart ass.
Hey, join the club.
I'm sorry. Well, starting with when I was a little kid, I was four-ish, no more, not any older than that, and just seeing a weird little creature on our patio through the glass doors, and it's the middle of the night, and I woke up in the den with it, and then, you know, years later, thinking about this, I thought, why would I be alone asleep in the den like that? That wouldn't happen. Anyway, so he was messing around with something, and I was kind of angry at it, like, why are you messing around in our yard, you know? And he turned and looked at me, and he was dressed in like a little silver suit, almost cartoonish in a way, and he had red glowing eyes, and he pointed this, at first I thought it was the hose, the garden hose, pointed it at me, but it was like some kind of gun, and I just remember screaming my head off and my cousin coming in to find out why I was screaming my head off. Oh, just so many other things. This is a thing that my husband and I shared in discussing our crazy childhood lives. Being in bed and consciously kind of calling or waiting for, because we knew they would come, these little beings, and they would, you know, float me out the door, float me up into the sky. And then I always talk about my invisible aliens. There's only one time where I saw grays, but it was in an altered state. And I was doing a lot of work with crystals and meditation at the time, and the Grays were at my bedroom window trying to get in. And it was a thing where they were really there in the in my sort of altered trance-like state. But if someone were to come into the room, they wouldn't have seen them, you know. But so they were there, but not there.
Why couldn't they get in?
Oh, because I was working with some stones and crystals and copper, and I was concentrating on channeling my energy through this wand and stones to keep them away. And they were very upset about that. They didn't like it, but it was keeping them away.
So were they there and then you started doing this to keep them away? Or did you start doing this and then they appeared and were like, ooh, we can't come in?
Right, exactly. I had already been working like this for a while and then they showed up.
So do you think you conjured them as well as, like, you've got to have a gray to not let it in, right?
No, I don't think I conjured them at all. Not consciously, anyway. I wasn't even thinking about that. And at the same time, I had been invited to a meeting that night of kind of a psychic meditation group, but I did not go. And so later, a day or two afterwards, a friend of mine who did go to that said that the woman leading it said to her, "You have a friend who was going to come tonight, but she did not. And right now she's battling entities."
She's so, babbling entities, or, meaning what, like speaking in tongues kind of thing?
No, like meaning I was, you know, dealing with these beings, call them aliens if you want, you know, whatever, that wanted to come in. Maybe babbling's too dramatic, but, you know, she said.
Well, what do you make of the fact that, that you know, I know you know all the analogous things of paranormal beings that want to come in, that need to be invited in, that can be blocked out. You know, if these are aliens from another planet or even another dimension, which is the favorite new flavor of alien, but the same thing.
Right.
How is that possible? I mean, what do you make of that? And then if it's something else, like, what do they want? I guess this is like what it really boils down to. Why does anything want us or need us to perceive it? Like, what is so important? What do they get out of it? Do you have any inkling from any of your experiences or even anything you've read that was sort of an aha moment into that?
That is a really good question. Yeah. Maybe, oh boy, you know, it could be anything or a combination of things from maybe they just like to mess with us. You know, maybe it's their idea of entertainment. Maybe it's we, by mistake, sometimes on purpose, some people do these things with great intent, and that is exactly their motivation to open up these doors. But other times it could be we're just stumbling along and we just stumbled into their path. Yeah, and of course, I'm just speculating here.
Yeah.
Maybe the veils or the walls, whatever you want to call them, are a lot thinner than we assume. And our walls we built up and all the things we've told ourselves throughout time, whether it's within a religious structure or whatever, is crumbled very easily. You know, it's not as strong as we think. Our little frameworks that we move around in.
Should it be?
Aren't as solid. Yeah. And we're a lot, in other words, we're a lot more vulnerable than we think we are.
Right. And so do you think that we should give into that or not? Because, you know, there's always this push pull in life to go with the establishment or not. But if you look at establishment, if you look at Christianity, I mean, one way to read, to me, one way to read the Jesus story is that this is the video game cheat code. Block out all of the other stuff as evil. Just put your focus on believing in Jesus, and you get to go to heaven. If you're honest with it, you get to go to... So, is that good, or is that stuff, quote-unquote, that you're blocking out, quote-unquote, evil, Is it a natural ecology that is all around us that we're blocking out, or is it really out to get us? And it's pretty good to probably a good idea to believe in Jesus and just go to heaven. Like I flip
well,
a coin.
Sure,
I guess
it's a lot easier, right. Isn't it? It's a lot easier. It's
yeah,
a lot easier.
Because we're just, always yeah. talking about, you know, especially counterculture mm-hmm. folks, you know, and subculture folks mm-hmm. are talking about the sheeple. They've mm-hmm. got to wake up and we've got to realize that this is an illusion and it's a small piece of reality, but mm-hmm. maybe it's the safe place of reality. Like maybe
right.
maybe we don't want to open well, that can of worms. Like, which is it?
I think for one thing, it's more than one thing. It's a lot of things. You know, the medium Amy Allen, I don't know if you ever watched that show,
no.
The Dead Files. Well, she goes through houses, picks up, you know, communicates with the dead and the, you know, no longer living and spirits and things. About three different times now, she's been going through a haunted location and saying, you know, there's an old man here and blah, blah, blah. And then she has said, oh, there's an alien here, you know, and I'm talking about an entity from not of this earth. And then she just moves on. She says, this isn't where I want to be or where I want to go. And she just goes back to the spirit world, you know, of ghosts and things. And I found that very interesting. Yeah.
Yeah.
Another time, this has happened three times now in my life. I'm talking with a group of people. Pretty intensely about UFOs, aliens, all of these experiences. And all of a sudden, I can feel it physically, the presence of other entities in the room. Not only, but it's very specific. They're not in the room, they're up like in a corner of the room. They're up by the ceiling. And they're listening. And they think it's pretty funny, actually. They're extremely intelligent. I can't see them, but they are there. Each of these experiences with different people, you know, different locations, different years, I keep it to myself. I'm thinking, okay, this is really weird. This feels real. And a person in the room will look over at me and in one instance, the person said, oh, you know they're here too, right? I said, what? She said, oh, yeah, that happens all the time here. And this was in a house where a lot of alien sightings took place and abductions and history of UFO sightings and even some hauntings. So who knows what that's about. Another time was in a house we lived in, and I think it was my husband that said, wow, this is going to sound really weird, and he explained exactly what I'd been feeling but I hadn't mentioned. And the other time was in this house where we are now, and I didn't say anything, but my friend said to me, you know, this is going to sound weird, but... So I don't know what that's about. I think that there are many things out there, many things, and some are ET, who knows, and they're all aware of us. They're a lot more aware of us than we are of them, and some of them are good, some are bad, some are indifferent, you know, just like with humans, we're all good, bad, or indifferent, depending. Some are out to get us. Some really don't care. You know, I think you have to be very careful when you start intentionally wanting. I'm not saying one should not do it. I'm not saying that at all. I'm just saying you have to be really careful, really clear about your intent, strong, know something about protecting yourself. Know something about why you're doing this, what you want to get out of it, and be willing to listen and learn and not accept at face value, you know, whatever thing comes through and says, my child, this is the answer, we're from blah, blah. Don't disbelieve it necessarily, but don't just say, okay, that's the answer, because we don't know.
And there's the perfect place to leave it, non-subscribers. Unless, of course, you want to click that subscribe tab, then you don't have to leave it at all. You can get the rest of this episode, all of the experience episodes, all of Dreamland, all of everything Whitley has on tap at unknowncountry.com for a pittance, commercial free, in its entirety, everything. I mean, right? Right? What a value. My thanks to Regan Lee, of course, for coming on the show, sharing a bit of her life experience with us. If you'd like to check her out online, you can find her at orangeorb.blogspot.com. From there, you can link through the labyrinth of websites of hers. And I think if you get to the end of it, there's a very special message from a conscious internet from the future. That I made that part up just now. But do find her, orangeorb.blogspot.com, and I will see you next week right here in the experience. Take care.